Welcome to our Remote Selling, Increasing Productivity and Sales Engagement virtually live event. We believe the future will be shaped by how people use digital tools and social platforms. Today's live event is designed to introduce you to the fundamental elements of sales, enablement, and productivity from a leadership perspective. In today's disrupted world, we have been forced to evolve. And leaders play a crucial role in the transition towards new tools, strategies, and ways of working. In this event, we will discuss how sales and marketing teams are acquiring new skills to collaborate remotely and how to enable a selling team with the right resources and training. To walk you through the future of marketing and sales, we are delighted to have today Tricycle Europe's co-founder and CEO, Johan Werber, who will be discussing how Tricycle continues to help technology companies set the foundation to win in the social space. Joining him in this discussion, we have Showpad's president, chief product officer, and co-founder, Louis Jonquier, who will be introducing the fundamental elements of remote sales enablement and productivity, fueled by the right digital tools and modern selling tactics. But how did we get here today, Tricycle and Showpad? We are partners who truly believe in driving meaningful customer conversations and building long-lasting relationships by providing teams with the tailored content, knowledge, and skills. Our goal as partners is for your team to be prepared to engage buyers and optimize their marketing and sales effectiveness anywhere, anytime, leveraging modern selling tactics. So let's have a look on our agenda for today. Today we will see from the history to the future of marketing and sales. We will also discuss today's marketing and sales skill set and how to enable a remote selling team with the right resources and training. We also would like to encourage you to send your questions here on our Q&A chat. Me and my colleague Javi will be monitoring them, and we would love to hear your thoughts, your comments, and ideas. So please feel free to send them over to us, and we will get back to you ASAP. Without further ado, over to you, Johan.
Hi, and thanks, Monica. And welcome, everybody, here today. And before we start, I want to take you all on a small journey and a quick story. This is a story about our digital selling summit of this year. So I want to take you back 4 months ago in March of this year, because March would have been a great month for us as a company, for we would have a big summit in the Johan Cruyff Arena. So that is the most digital soccer stadium in the world. It was our chance of meeting our clients and our prospects and our partners and peers and the colleagues even. So that was really nice to happen. But I think we all know what actually happened, because it didn't, right? It didn't because of COVID that came across Europe in March. In the end of March, everything was closed, so that didn't happen. And I was a little bit, frustrated, at least to say, because we spent so much time in preparation of such a big event, and but I was mostly worried about all the missed opportunities we got out of that, because we didn't get this chance to speak to all these people. So what we did, we quickly transformed our way of communicating and being in touch with the people to online events, like we're having right now on Microsoft Teams or Zoom, and we use LinkedIn to stay in touch with our, with our audience. And since then, I must say, we're not only having more meaningful discussions, but we also managed to intensify the touch points with them. So actually, it's a good thing, and everything stays the same. It's just a different channel that we are using now to be in contact. So I'm not frustrated anymore, and for sure I'm not worried anymore, because I see that we can still keep in contact and we can still deliver and tell the story to our audience. So just imagine the productivity gain that we have in this new world. So my name is Jochem Verberg, and today I want to take you together with Louis Jonkheer. I want to take you on this journey and to get you a good overview of what's happening, how we got here in the first place, and how we can win in this new era. So a quick intro on Tricycle. I know Monica, you already gave a good overview, but we believe that the future will be shaped by how people will use digital tools and social platforms. And what we do at Tricycle, we build a foundation for technology companies to win in the social space. Now, we do that with a lot of really nice customers. Here they are. They are our global customers. We actually learn a lot from, and for them, we help them with consultancy, coaching, training, and support for their executives and their marketing and sales team. And I think today it's even more important than it has been in the last 10 years. This is roughly what we do. Today here we have Louis, Louis Jonkheer of Showpad. So please, Louis, can you share your story and introduce yourself and Showpad?
Absolutely. And thanks for the invitation, Jochem. Very happy to be part of this event today. So I'm Louis Jonkheer, co-founder and president of Showpad. So Showpad is a sales enablement platform. And so what we basically do as a company is we want to make sure that salespeople, your customer-facing employees, do have the right knowledge, the right skills and tools to have great conversations. Because we believe that in sales, it's ultimately about the quality of the conversations you have with your customers and making sure that your customer-facing teams are ready and organized to make that happen. So we're a company founded about 9 years ago. We really, I would say, built together with a few other companies the sales enablement category, which is now getting a lot of traction, especially with the COVID crisis. So we were working with companies across the world, 1,200 customers, mid-market enterprise, and have had a lot of fun in the last 9 years helping our customers solve their challenges. So super happy to be here. Yes, back to you, Jochem.
Thank you. Thank you, Louis. That's wonderful. And again, I cannot stress enough, really happy that we are partners with the same mindset of how the future will look like. So happy that you're here today. And yeah, let's learn a lot from you today. But also, let's introduce the audience. So my colleague Javi will prepare a little link in the Q&A you can find here below. So we would like to know, what is your current role in your organization, just so that we have an understanding of the audience today. So I will give you a couple of seconds, minutes maybe, to fill this in. And Javi, when you got the results in, please let us know. Oh, there we go already.
Yes, Jochem, you can see now the screen,
I guess. Yes, we can see the screen, and I believe everybody can see the screen as well. So we're getting the live results in right now. Really good to see that it's a mixed group, I must say. Sales enablement there, marketing, sales, a couple of executives, HR, and other, of course. Well, good to see this is coming in here. And to give a good overview of the audience today. And indeed, as you've seen, it's a mix. And that's actually what we are dealing with today's world and in our services. So let's go back to our slides. Interesting to understand, like, what is changing for marketing, for sales. And then, of course, we have the executive approach here. So how can you help in marketing and sales enablement? So thank you for answering that question. Let's dive into the topic. And the topic of today, of course, is what is changing and how do you need to set up for the future? And I believe in order to understand, where we are going in the future, we need to understand, like, how we got here. And even, like, not the last 10 years, but even the last 4 months, it pushed us even further and faster into the situation we are in today. So let's look at this image here. So we all know the physical world. It's out there. Everybody knows marketing and sales, what you can do. You have billboards. So let's go door by door. And it's just the physical world that we all know of. And on top of that, we now well, more and more and more, especially the last 10 years, we have this digital world. And the digital world, this one is like an ever-increasing speed of innovation happening. And that means that sellers and marketers are in a constant pace of skill up or boost up their skills in order to keep up with all this productivity that's happening over there. So the digital world really was a game changer in marketing and sales. And out of that, out of the digital world, there came the social world alive, the social media that we all know by now. You cannot think around that anymore. So think of this of a seller. A seller needs to tell the story to the customer, to the leads, to prospects, through all these different channels with using all these different tools. So that means to be today's seller, yes, you can be productive, but think about how much you should know and how much you should stay up to date with all that new technology. What is really nice to know is that luckily not everything is changing, right? So look at this. What stays the same is that it all is about relationships. So build up relationships in order to get more business. And you do that by building up your trust, showing empathy, and showing your good manners. And you do that in the physical world, in the digital world, and in the social space. And this is actually the challenge. And Louis, I've been to your summit a while back, and you talked about this part, especially about the fast speed of innovation in the digital world. So what's your aim at this? Can you quickly tell us?
Definitely. I mean, I think the biggest change that actually happened because of technology in the last 10, 15 years is that your customers became a lot more demanding, because they're able to find more information themselves, look up more, go to review sites, speak with peers. And when they're having interactions with salespeople, they have a lot more expectations from those conversations. And so I think what I see happening is that salespeople need to be more moving to what I call like buying consultants, and people who truly can guide their customers, be very knowledgeable and be able to deliver a very personalized message and story. So I think like that is one thing we definitely see. A second thing is, and I think with the COVID pandemic, I would say a lot of companies have been catapulted into virtual selling, selling remotely. And I mean, it is different to deliver trust, to deliver empathy, to deliver that experience that we have in person. And so part of my presentation will be about that. And I think we're still at the beginning of understanding like how we sell virtually, how we engage with each other virtually. So I expect a lot of innovation on that front from technology.
Yeah, so it's indeed what you said, like we don't know yet how things will play out. We are in the midst of it. Yep. We do have an understanding of companies that were already investing, especially in the digital part, now are a little bit in a better shape than companies that didn't. So, you know, that's the first glimpse of that. But especially on the tools that you said, and I remember what I said on your summit a while back. You talked about the explosion of tools, and I always see it from two angles. So on the one angle, you have you know, it's good for productivity. It's always your productivity tools, and you know, you have your CRM and your Outlook and everything, and it will in the end make you a better marketer, better seller. But you also need to understand and adopt to these new tools. Otherwise, it will not do you any good at all. So actually, that's a question I want to ask to the audience today. And let's go to that one over here. Again, Avi will put this into the Q&A section, so you can all leave your answers over there. So how many tools are you using? Just to get an idea, and I just want to know, because it's I hear different stories, and it would be good to see what is happening. Okay, so the question is out there. And Javi, do you get results in?
Yes, Jochem, I think it's live now. We got so far five results.
Okay, slowly. Also, let me use this time to say, if you have any questions in between, please leave them in the Q&A, and both Monica and Javi will be able to answer and to pick it up, or give them to Louis and me, so we can discuss it live in the in this event. Okay, there we go. Okay, results coming in, and yeah, so. You see already between 5 and 10, 10 and 20. So it's actually a lot of apps, and it goes actually pretty quick. If you start thinking, and I'll ask it to a seller at any moment in time, I always get the answer, well, yeah, Outlook, CRM, and yeah, I have an app. And then, but if you start thinking about it, then it just piles up and it goes to a crazy number. And indeed, I think if you actually look at the real number, if you would think about it super hard, then it will even be more than 20, all the apps that you use on a daily basis in your daily work. Okay, well, we see the results coming in, but let's get back to the presentation over here. So there we go. Again, thanks for your for the answers to this question, and nice to see that indeed everybody's using these tools. The next part I want to discuss is it's not only the digital tools that are increasingly being put on the work for a seller, but it's also the way that people want to be communicated to. So we just spoke about the social world, remember? So we had the digital world and the social world. And in this graph, or this box actually, you see the difference between the number one choice that people have in how they want to be communicated to by a company. So what's the first choice of being in contact? And this actually comes from the Mary Meeker Internet Trends Report. It comes out every year. It's a huge document every year, and it's really nice. I take a close look at that because she has a really nice way of showing where the eyes are today. So are we on online? Are we on social? Where are we? And where the marketing budget is spent. So that gives a good idea of, hey, where are we going in the future? Are there gaps? Are people investing on specific areas? And that's where you need to look and to be there, because your audience is going to be there. So what we see here clearly, so their preferred business contact for the millennials, they're actually on the left bottom, the 48%. They choose 48% for their first choice to be in contact through web chat or social. And if you look at the right hand side, you have like typically your executives level, right? They are on that side. And you see that there's a big gap between those percentages. So we all say that millennials are so digitally savvy and on social, everything, but look at what's coming even after millennials. It's getting up, the number. So it's here to stay. And it's really good if you are a seller, when you want to tell a story, you need to understand where you need to be to tell that story, and you need to understand how that works and the best way to do that. So think about our last slide with building up trust and showing empathy. How do you do that on different channels? And then what are the manners on these channels? It doesn't work in the same way. So this is another thing that that a seller these days needs to be skilled in. And this is how we need to help them to get there. So this trend is not going, it's only going upwards. Actually, this part is something we start with in our executive programs that we do. We show them, hey, this is where most of your employees actually are at, and also most of your customers and your clients. So it's all awareness of where we are today. All right. So another thing, what's changed for sellers in the last, let's say, 10 years, we all know we come from this area where we were selling products. And let me give you a quick example of Signify, the former Philips lighting. They used to sell light bulbs. Quick and easy, there we go. And a seller had a good life. But then, we all changed to selling solutions. So solution selling is really, well, I think it's a topic that's been discussed a lot over the last few years, let's say the last 10, maybe 5 years specifically. And this means that a seller already needs to change his mindset. So instead of just selling the product, you need to understand what the full solution is for the customer. But it doesn't stop over here. So the last few years, I've been hearing and seeing this a lot more, experiences. So a customer wants an experience. They want to buy an experience. Again, it has to do with the story that we tell as marketing and as a seller. So let's go back to the example of Signify. Right? They are not selling light bulbs anymore. They're not selling light. That is the solution. But now they are selling a light experience. So think about retail, right? So in retail, you can have a light experience where the customers, because of the light, will experience us, you know, and get an experience to get from A to B in a store, for example, or when you try on clothes, so how does it look in a specific lights? How can you play with that light? So that's the light experience. It goes much further, means the seller needs to understand how that works and needs to understand all these kind of models. So again, this is something for a seller to understand and to also get skills in. So you already see that it's piling up for people. They need to understand a lot more. It all comes together here, where marketing and sales, all the way back to the 1920s even here, to today, where marketing and sales come together. And then even today, we have this extra level to be added, and that is the remote selling. And I must say, I think we can state that a modern seller today needs to be constantly working on the skill set to, you know, to adopt to all these new ways of selling, these new tools, these new platforms. And Louis, I know you're also really into this topic here. So what's your aim here on like how did we get here, and how do we need to move forward in the future?
Absolutely. I mean, so how I always, when I talk about the history of sales and marketing, I the first part I always talk about is that, like, as from the 60s to the years 2000, we had what I call the madman era. And I would say the era where sales and marketing is all about storytelling, connecting with other humans, touching upon their emotions, and really, again, deeply connecting with the pains your customers are currently facing. I think what happened around the year 2000 is because of technology, we've seen an overload of tools and platforms for sales and marketing. It really brought us in a place where, I mean, it was all about scale. It was all about how do we talk with as many people as possible? How do we send as many emails, LinkedIn messages? Like, how do we get as fast and as efficient as possible? And I think, in a way, in the last 20 years, we've lost a bit the art of storytelling. We've lost a bit the fact that when we're talking to a customer, we always should deliver a very personalized, valuable, and authentic message. And I think, I mean, everybody here in this event is being spammed as we speak on LinkedIn, on email, with stuff that doesn't matter. And we have to stop that. And I think we're now entering a post-COVID into a world where, again, customers will be less patient for those things that are happening now, and they will demand more value, demand more things that really matter for them, and not the spam we're seeing today. So it's a bit unfortunate that technology brought us today in a big way to that, but I believe that we're going to see a lot of improvement on that in the next few years.
Yes, it's actually good. So if I understand it correctly, you say, hey, marketing was focusing on mass engagement, losing the indeed like their initial role of storytelling. And then now sellers being more visible, I must say, to buyers, they also need to understand the storytelling technique, or, you know, so that comes together. And indeed, you know, people looking for shortcuts all the time. So you said, like, spamming with LinkedIn messages, that's actually, you know, the opposite of the idea of how you use that. And the same with email, of course, email campaigns. So it's really nice to have that understanding and where that's going. Actually, I think because of the situation today, of the last couple of months, you said, hey, did this catapulted us into the future because we needed to work remotely. But now we just talked about the last 10 minutes, I think we talked about how the work of a seller changed, and that there needs to be a big, you know, they need to work on their skills, and we need to help them. And from a sales enablement perspective, we need to support it so that they are able to do so. And I think you wanted to ask a question here to the audience that we have prepared. So let's get to that and see what's coming out. Yeah. Javi, I think you can share that link again and see what the results are in a minute or so. So yes, so it's really like, hey, how do you educate and train sellers remotely? What's your how would you explain the question the best, Louis?
Yeah, I mean, so for me, it's really about, again, we've all been faced in the last months with the reality that we're not together in a single room anymore, or that we're not in the office together anymore, but that all of us work remotely, sell remotely, interact remotely. And over the last 20 years, we've been building up a practice of how we coach and train people in person, like how a dynamic of a sales team in an office works, how you can give feedback as a manager. I mean, all of those things. And I think with the virtual world suddenly being like pushed very heavily on us, that like there's something to learn about how we do this in a complete remote environment. Because even when we will start returning back to the office, we'll see that sellers will continue to sell virtual, and they will continue to spend maybe a majority of their time from their home office. And so I think we need to really think that through.
Yeah, indeed. It's indeed like what you said, like, you know, working from the home office, that gives a whole different level here in how we can support there. And well, actually, pretty good here. What do you think about these results that are coming in?
I mean, I'm very happy to see that most of the people already are moving to a virtual training and coaching program. And it's I think keep doing the things you've been doing in the last 5 to 15 years, like that would not be the right approach. I think managing people virtually, coaching them, enabling them is a different set of tactics you need to master. So yeah, very happy to see this.
Yeah, good. Okay, let's go back, Javi. Okay, going back to the presentation.
Yes. I think there. Now it's list time.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so you can share your screen, Louis.
Yes, share. So normally you should be able to see my slide deck. Can you maybe quickly confirm, Jochen, before I start?
Yes, I can see.
Yes, cool. So my presentation will be about 15 minutes. If people have questions, feel free to ask them in the chat, and I think at the end of the presentation we'll still have some time to walk through them. So basically I wanted to talk about how you can enable a remote selling team and a sales team that typically stands in a very virtual environment. So what I've basically done is, like, I've took the example of Showpad. I mean, we're a sales enablement platform, and we need to be the best in enablement to become credible to our customers. So what I wanted to share is like how we as Showpad, a company with about 250 people in our commercial organization, manage, coach, and enable them remotely. Because like managing remotely has been something that has been part of our DNA since the early beginnings of Showpad. So in a way, we're used to this. Now, a framework that I always use to explain how people learn, how they are being coached, and how they are being trained is the 70-20-10 rule. People learn 10% through traditional education, 20% from peers, and 70% by actually doing something very hands-on. And so I want to walk very quickly through how the virtual world is changing and how we apply the 70-20-10. And so starting with the traditional education, I mean, it's an important piece. It's only about 10% of what people need to learn, but like even that part has been changed drastically over the last few months. And so I specifically want to focus on classroom training, and because I've seen some people still doing that, I would assume that most companies still would do some sort of classroom training for some pieces that is necessary. But if you're bringing that to a virtual program, there's some, I would say, tips and tricks I want to share with success we've seen. And so I think the first issue you have with any training is that people lose, I would say, patients are like they lose interest very quickly. Like the very typical goldfish analogy, where we have less, I would say, patience than a goldfish to learn and to keep attention. I think that is something to really think about. So if you're thinking about a virtual classroom experience, like you have to create an experience that drives engagement. I think very similar to this event, everything you do virtually with your sales team needs to be an experience. And so with Showpad, we have, I would say, branded our training experience to something that we call the enablement zone, which is something that happens every 2 weeks. And what I want to share is like a very quick example of how a virtual training session with us looks like. And so as you see, we have four parts here. I want to quickly zoom in into all of the topics we covered here with some of the tools and tips and I would say experience-focused actions that we have. So first of all, every time and when we start a virtual training session, there's an executive update. And I think like what we always try to do is to not have a single presenter talk longer than 5 minutes, make it really interactive via Q&A. I think like most companies out there already are doing that, but very important to keep those types of discussions very active. Have people in your enablement organization or in your training org actively making sure that people ask questions. Because again, if you don't do that, you will lose interest. The second part of our enablement zone is then, for example, a marketing update. And we always, I would say, like ask our marketing teams or the teams who present to tell the story in different ways. And like sometimes we just have people sitting next to like a physical whiteboard drawing stuff. Sometimes we use at the Zoom whiteboard application, but I think experimenting with different ways in how to tell a story is very important. And so there's lots of tools and new, I would say, techniques there that are very important. Something we very often use with our enablement zones are breakouts. So our enablement zones typically take about 90 minutes to 2 hours. And I mean, nobody wants to listen to other people for an hour, 2 hours in a row. So it's a capability that most video conferencing solutions have, the ability to create breakout rooms where you actually, in the middle of a training session, split yourself up from one group of 250 to 10 groups of 25 people. And there you can ask people questions, they can collaborate. There's a certain exercise they need to perform, again, to make sure that interactivity and collaboration is very high. And the moment that we've done that breakout, there's always a presentation where somebody can be asked to present the specific topic they've prepared. So this is one example of an agenda we have, although like we've seen great success with it. And we also started to adjust in the beginning, providing virtual presentations for an hour, but we saw that people didn't listen, they didn't took notice about breaking it up in separate sections, having breakout rooms, virtual, more interactive tools to present, to learn is super important. And so this is, then again, the overview of an example of how we do it. Something I also would recommend if you have those virtual classroom sessions, like always practice them with a smaller group, like especially with technology, if things go wrong, well, like it's hard to hide that, right? Like everybody sees it, it creates a very unpleasant, awkward feeling. So always make sure that you practice your sessions with a smaller group to make sure you get used to using those new techniques. And then making the session outcome-based or action-oriented, this is something I'll talk a lot about in the end, because for me, the key to virtual coaching and enablement are like action-based outcomes you wanna have of your selling team. So again, virtual training, a quick summary. It's an experience, drive motivation, practice it. And after any session you have with your sales team, always make sure that they have to do something. But again, that is something that I will talk about towards the end of my presentation. So the second piece is then the 20%, and that is basically social learning. And like, don't underestimate how much people learn from just interacting with each other in the office, from sitting at the water cooler, getting a coffee, seeing a sales rep close a deal, high-fiving, asking, hey, how did you do it? Like a lot of the knowledge people have, like they're getting from those very informal interactions. And in a virtual world, like you have to think a little bit differently about that, just because of the fact that you're not sitting in the same room and you're not able to share those very organically. So how do you make that a reality? So how do you move some of the things we do as humans every single day when we see each other to a virtual world where most people are working remotely? And so one of the key techniques we do here we use with Showpad, so we use our virtual meeting recordings to coach sellers and share best practices. And so I would say the most simple way here is that everybody uses Teams or GoToMeeting or Zoom, like just start recording your calls with customers. And we've done some research, and a lot of your customers have no issue with recording a customer conversation. And the value of having a customer conversation recorded is tremendous. And that's where I really want to talk about in the next few slides. Because basically, if you start to get your customer conversations into a system, like there's a lot of knowledge and there's a lot of coaching opportunity that you have here. And the technology that Shobhat has built is something we called conversation intelligence. And so every conversation we're having with customers gets recorded into Shobhat. We do slide detection, we do text analysis, we're able to see when sellers are talking, like there's a whole transcription happening of that conversation. And it's really very powerful to get it in the system because like when we record those conversations, anybody else in the sales organization can go into those calls and see how some salespeople are having conversations with their customers. And so analyze what your sellers say and how your customers respond. There's a lot of value in listening to calls of other salespeople, especially if you can start to segment them into little pieces. Now, something that we've seen as extremely effective is that we use those recordings to actually coach our salespeople. So a manager sits together with a sales rep, they go to a recorded conversation, they go to the part where there's, I would say, the product demo, and then they listen to the call, they give feedback, they coach, and it's an extremely, extremely rewarding and effective practice to really have. And having a formalized coaching process and a coaching program around that is super important. That's about those real life meetings are for us the cornerstone in how we coach virtually. Okay. And then the second thing we do is like we share, as I've mentioned, some of those recordings with the rest of the sales team. Like if you want to learn as a seller how your colleague is doing a sales presentation, like make sure they can find some of those recordings. Again, within the Shobhat platform, completely integrated in what we do, but it's also very easy to just start recording your calls to then, I would say, make some little clips of that. Very effective. And again, like this is an example within Shobhat where those meeting recordings are proactively shared with the rest of our organization. So recording your meetings, extremely important, extremely valuable to coach. The second technique we have at Shobhat when it comes to social learning is that we proactively share sales wins and failures. So you can do this in tools like Slack or Teams, or even email if you don't have a collaboration tool. But every time a deal is being closed, there's an automatic notification that gets sent to the whole organization. And we ask every seller to proactively share the reasons why they've won, why the customer selected our product, against which competitor we won the deal from, and then have a collaboration around it. Again, this is typically something you would see by seeing a salesperson cheer in the office and then explaining what happened. Doing something like this makes it very tangible for the rest of your organization. Because if you're working virtually, it's important that you get those types of updates. On the other hand, we do the same thing with failures. Like if a deal gets lost, like that also is being channeled immediately to the whole company, where we share the reason why we've lost and what we've learned from it. And then again, you start to have a collaboration on that. So in a virtual environment, it is super important to do those types of things because you're not seeing them when you're working at home behind your computer. And then thirdly, formalize your mentoring and coaching initiatives. Mentoring and coaching is something that typically happens very organically. It is something where, again, there's a water cooler conversation, then the manager jumps by the desk, like gives some feedback, looks at an email. And if you're working remotely, virtually, like you have to formalize those programs. And a big issue we see today is that sales managers don't focus enough time on managing their people. They only spend about 30 minutes. But like what we're seeing with Shobhat, but lots of our customers, is that sales coaching actually has the biggest impact of most of the enablement programs that you run. But it's shocking to see how little companies out there actually have a very formalized coaching program in place. And again, this is, so we for example, use Winning by Design. So they are our partner as well. They're a sales training, sales methodology company who has developed a very strong, I would say, process around setting up a cadence with regards to coaching, training. And it's something we use, like definitely have a look at their website or on YouTube. Like they've developed great content around that topic as well to learn from and to consume. But again, the point I want to make here is formalize, like make it very clear for a manager what is expected from him or her when they're coaching their people, and like a whole methodology really stands behind that. You cannot survive without this in a virtual enablement environment. So again, people learn through social interactions. If you do this virtually, use those meeting recordings, because then sellers can be coached better, they can share best practices, proactively share sales wins and failures, like create a culture of sharing, and that can happen automatically. Make sure that you make it clear to your sellers what you expect from them, like they need to explain why they won or why they lost. And then thirdly, formalize your mentoring and coaching programs. But then we get to the 70%, the on-the-job learning. And this is basically how most people learn the most, like the first 10 and the 20%, a very important basis to start from. But it's basically in this piece that your sellers will learn the most, at the 70%. And this is basically where I think there's a lot of opportunity for us to do better. Because basically, if you give people training, if you just come from the training class, I mean, you ask people to complete a test, like here are 10 questions, answer them, multiple choice, single selection, whatever it is, and then that's done. I mean, that doesn't work anymore. So what we strongly believe in with Showpad is that you have to give them assignments that they can do throughout their day, throughout the work that they're doing, to practice actual selling situations. And I'll give you an example of that, because we have to move from testing to practicing. And so, for example, if you look at like most sales enablement platforms, Showpad being one of them, like we have a technology that allows managers to very easily give assignments to salespeople. And so let's say that you just deployed a new product, or that you just have released a new messaging, which most of us have done with the COVID crisis, then we can give them very practical assignments, like pitch this product, record yourself on a video, or do a role play with those two people on Microsoft Teams or Zoom, and it's also being recorded. Write a customer email, give a presentation using marketing content. So the ability to give small assignments to the team after they've learned something is extremely crucial of making sure that people start to learn as they start to practice their pitch, practice the new messaging, the new products they have to sell, etc. So a very important movement that you see when it comes to sales training and coaching. So what we do with those, I would say, assignments. So let's say we just released a new product. I learned about it. I did a little test, and then I got an assignment that you see here. Okay, now practice your pitch, and as a manager, like, and then provide it to your manager. And then your manager has the ability to get feedback on it, to rate it, to give you specific, I would say, elements to focus on. But what we've seen with Showpad is that if we apply such a practice assignment, so for example, recording yourself on a video doing a pitch, we see that typically salespeople practice 6 to 7 times before they send it to their manager. But those are like 6 to 7 times that they actually practice a specific story they have to tell to a customer. So do not underestimate the amount of things people learn, especially not if it is linked with actually getting feedback from managers or being coached. And then again, what we also do, if we have those, what we call pitch IQs, our salespeople have to practice something they've learned. Like, it's not only sent to the manager, like you also have the ability to share it with the whole company or with the whole sales team. Everybody then can actually see the pitches of other sellers out there, which they can rank based on the score or based on a similar group of salespeople. So again, this is something where salespeople learn. They learn from their manager, but they can also learn from others by seeing what they are doing. And so a very important piece. So on the job learning, again, outside the fact that sellers learn when they're selling, it's extremely important to create a culture where salespeople can practice, where they can be given assignments. And again, in a physical world, like often you would see those physical role plays, like a manager gets in, they say, okay, let's simulate a sales conversation. That is, again, something you have to put in a program. You have to make that part of your process. And part of everything you do is to make sure that salespeople can practice something, can do something, instead of just asking them to passively give or perform a specific test. And so that's basically something we really believe in. So this is, I would say, the presentation that I wanted to give. So I've did it in 15 minutes as promised. And so I think we're now ready for some Q&A. Cool.
Yes. Can you guys hear me? Monica here?
Yes.
Yes, perfect. So we have a few questions. Louis, thank you so much for the presentation. The audience is really enjoying it. So let me address here the first question. What is the biggest challenge you have as a sales leader regarding this topic?
Yeah. Cool. So I think the biggest challenge you have is, like, first of all, this is a cultural change, right? Because we've done this in the same way the last 5 to 15 years. And I think specifically with coaching, we see like a big challenge with sales leaders to bring that into the organization, to move it from a very inner, like organic, not formalized, informal program to something you make very, very tangible and clear for the rest of the organization. I mean, we've seen that companies who implement like a very effective formal coaching program like drastically outperform their peers, because that culture of coaching, that culture of feedback can become really a differentiator for your business if you do that in a very sustainable way. Technology is only a little piece of that, because it facilitates that coaching. Like, where the real difficulty is like in performing that change management in your company, also with your salespeople, because some salespeople will maybe not like the fact that customer conversations can be recorded, that others can see what they do and say. Eh? And so I think there's a lot there where we need leadership to drive that change. That's how I would look at it.
It's a good one, Louis. And let me also quickly jump into that, because you said indeed it starts with leadership to be aware of that point. And you've talked about coaching, and the question is also about, you know, the culture in the company. Mm-hmm. And actually that also starts with coaching. So first step always here, what I would say is that to get everybody on the same page, to get everybody aware of the situation, and then move forwards from that point. And the thing is, I've seen it with customers, when they do not have that first part in place, they will just start doing something, and then you get like, hey, I don't want to share my success, or hey, I don't want to spend time, or, you know, well, if you're all in the same game, then you can move forward. So all coaching begins with that point, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but great question. And I hope this answered the question as well. If not, please let us know.
Great. Thank you both. We have also a question coming from Alistair Fox. We produce sales enablement content, for example, Pally books, not training. All our clients use different content products, including Showpad. What are the best ways of sharing content with salespeople?
Yeah, great, great question. And I would say for a big part, that is what, I mean, our company has helped our customers with solving, right? I think, how do you make sure that sellers find what they need and that they have the effective messaging, the effective content presentations to actually have great conversations? I think, and for me, part of the answer already was in the question. Like, I strongly believe in the idea of creating playbooks or sales plays, where, again, step one is always making sure that when your sellers have to search for content, when they need to find something, that they have the tool to very easily do that. I think this is definitely where it starts. More importantly for me is the idea of what we call a sales play. And a sales play for me is basically, call it a piece of content, call it a web page, call it whatever you want, but it's basically, I would say, a specific scenario that you're supporting with messaging and content. So for example, an example of a sales play for me is, this is a sales play that is going to talk about how you can sell this new product to this industry. Yeah? In this play, you have to give context about like to who do you need to sell this as a salesperson? Like, well, what are the pain points? What are the specific buyer personas you have to talk to? So that is step one. And then secondly, you then have to share as well, like, what are what's the knowledge that they need to learn in order to tell that story? Yeah? Like messaging guides, maybe there's a white paper, maybe there's like a recorded training that they have from somebody else talking about that. And what are the tools they can use to then actually have that conversation with a customer? Yeah? So it's about making sure you have a very clear purpose of a sales play. Yeah? It's also important that you talk very clearly about, like, to who can I sell this and what are their pain points? To then, what is the knowledge? What are the tools? And then the final step for me is always about, what are some other people in the organization that I can go to learn from? And I think organizing content around sales plays is basically organizing content around topics that salespeople are interested in. They're not interested in a marketing folder. They're interested in, how can I upsell this product to this customer? And make all of your content focused around a specific initiative like that. So yeah, that's how I would answer that question.
Great. Thank you very much, Louis. We have one more question from the audience. Any tips on changing culture in an international sales organization? So salespeople will be more open on sharing their best practices, wins, losses, so everyone can learn.
Yeah, definitely. It's I mean, for me, this starts with the leadership, right? I think every cultural change starts with the CEO. So I think more and more we see companies being forced to become like a little bit more transparent, not only to their customers but also internally. I mean, we've started, for example, when we started to implement our sharing losses and wins project within the company, like we started with selecting, I would say, a group of salespeople who were like the trial group in that, right? So there were, I think, a group of 4 or 5 salespeople in which we knew that they were very, I would say, happy to start sharing this openly, not only the wins, but also the failures. Like sharing wins is easy, sharing failures is a little bit harder. And so we started doing that I would say isolating a group of 5 people and then like slowly increasing that group of people. And I would say extremely important with, I would say, sharing those wins and losses is that you use them even outside of that Slack channel or that team channel, the Microsoft Teams channel. Like you start to use them as well in your all hands. So for example, every 2 weeks with Showbuy, we have what we call Showbuy, which is basically a company all hands. And a big piece of that all hands meeting is where we select some of the wins that have been talked about in a channel, like give some more explanation around it, but also share some failures. So make it visible for people. Like talk about it openly as a leadership team, but again, start slowly because in some organizations this will take a while before it really gets used. But yeah, start slow, but communicate often. So that's how we did it.
Okay, Louis, and again, let me add a bit to that from our perspective. So the culture, international, that's an interesting combination because in these global companies, right, we have many different cultures in one company all working together. And now even we see that we actually are working together with these wonderful tools. So it's seamlessly that everything goes well from a technology perspective, but then from a cultural perspective, it's a little bit more difficult. And yeah. Actually, when we started with, with coaching, of course, we believe fully in that. That's the main thing that we do in sales, marketing, executives, like, let's start with the culture first, because you cannot say, hey, this is how we're going to do it in the US. Actually, how we started out, a big project from the US coming to Europe, and of course, it didn't work. So you have your whole design ready and it didn't work. So what we did is change it around and see, okay, what do we do in specific countries? What's here? What's in the Netherlands, Germany, Spain? And then take that to the rest of the world, like in Asia, in EMEA and Africa. You know, it's different angles. So as part of an answer to this question would be just not to just copy paste whatever you have and roll it out globally, but really take a local approaches and be super respectful to cultural differences. So when designing something like this, please add cultural diversity in your team of designing and ask them what they think about it. Because sometimes, and we learned the hard way, sometimes you want to push for something and to let them share success and people say, oh, but I don't want to share success. Not because I'm selfish, but because I don't want to, you know, be seen as a successful person. That could be in some cultures. We learned the hard way, quickly changed that by having a more cultural diverse team. Super important, I think, in this game. Okay, Monica, how are we on time?
Yeah, so unfortunately, we don't have time for more questions, but please, if people still have questions, send it to us and we will get back to you offline. Thank you very much both for your answers.
Okay, so let me then share the screen again. And I was just checking the other remarks that are coming in the Q&A. I saw a flying coachman. I think that's a well-known person here. So thank you for all the attention there. Last minute, I just want you all to think about 2 actions that you can take in the next week. To really sustainably change at scale something in your company? So what can you do based on what you've learned today in order to be well set up for the future? I think, Louis, you shared a beautiful story about how you can do it, how coaching is important, how technology can support that with taping sales calls. And it's a little bit out of the comfort zone for some people. But yeah, if you've seen your presentation, I think people will be really happy to start trying and to do that. So thank you for that. So everybody, please take two actions ready for you. What can you do? Because if you don't do it, you know, we're not getting anywhere. So thank you for all today. I have a last slide over here for you. We want to be connected, of course, in this digital space and in the social space. So we prepared a couple of QR codes, and you can actually scan them, and you can go to Showpad, to Tricycle, to me, or to Louis, and you can invite us, and we can be connected and learn from each other. Thank you all. Thank you, Louis. It was wonderful to talk to you.
Yes, likewise.
And back to Monica.
Thank you all very much for joining us today. And thank you both for this insightful presentation. Thank you. See you soon.